Welcome to Where He Leads Me with Mike and Laura Harris. Where He Leads Me will help to bring understanding of God's kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Join Mike and Laura as they discuss biblical truths to help people walk in their God-given purpose and calling.
Welcome back to Where He Leads Me. I'm Mike Harris.
And I'm Laura Harris.
We are very happy to be with you today. And Laura, the last couple of weeks, we've been talking about covenants. And so today we're going to finish up with three more covenants. But why don't you recap for our listeners where we've been the last couple of weeks, and then let's get started where we're going today.
Well, Mike, we have been talking about covenants, and covenants are agreements based on relationship, and we primarily see this in the Bible in God's covenant with Noah, Abraham, Moses, David, and in the New Covenant. The previous programs are available on whereheleadsme.org under the radio broadcast tab, and so we just invite people who maybe have not heard those previous programs to go back and catch up with where we have been. We just see that God has bound himself to his agreement to these people in Scripture, and we as Gentile believers come into the blessing of those covenants because of Israel.
Well, why don't we pick up today with the covenant with Moses?
Mike, we do pick up with the covenant with Moses, and as we have said on the previous programs, all of the covenants of God were with Israel. Even the new covenant was a covenant with Israel. The covenant with Moses basically establishes Israel as a nation. Just to recap, the covenant with Noah was a covenant with all living flesh, because the Lord said that he would not destroy the earth again by water, and this was a covenant to every living creature. When we get to the covenant with Abraham, we see a covenant with one man and his descendants. It is a covenant with a man. We get to the covenant of Moses, and we see that it is a covenant with a nation. When we get to the covenant of David, we see that it is a covenant of a kingdom. And then we get to the new covenant, and it is a perpetual, everlasting covenant. So we see the ripples in the pond getting wider and wider as we go through the discussion of these covenants.
Laura, let's pick up in Exodus 19, starting at verse 1 through 7. In the third month after the children of Israel had gone out of the land of Egypt, on the same day they came to the wilderness of Sinai. For they had departed from Rephidim, had come to the wilderness of Sinai, and camped in the wilderness. So Israel camped there before the mountain. And Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel, you have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be a special treasure to me above all people, for all the earth is mine. And you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words of which you shall speak to the children of Israel." So Moses came and called for the elders of the people, and laid before them all these words which the Lord commanded him.
Well, Mike, in this covenant, God establishes the people of Israel on Mount Sinai after he had led them out of slavery in Egypt. We see that the covenant with Abraham was with Abraham and his descendants. The descendants of Abraham went down into Egypt. They were put into slavery, and they were kept in slavery for 400 years. So we pick up with the people of Israel coming out of slavery in Egypt. And so God is establishing another covenant with them. God establishes the law with the people of Israel, and it is how they are supposed to act going forward as they have come out of slavery. the law is not really meant to be a salvation, but a set of expectations that the Lord has on how His people are going to act and how they're going to behave. And we get to Exodus 20, and that's where the Lord gives the Ten Commandments to Moses. But this covenant with Moses was a conditional covenant, and it defined blessings and curses based on obedience. So if the people were obedient to the things that the Lord was telling them to do, they would be blessed. But if they were disobedient to the things that the Lord was telling them to do in the law, they would be cursed.
Well, Laura, we see in Exodus 19, verse 5, it says, "Now, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be a special treasure to me above all people, for all the earth is mine. And you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation."
And you see that very first line, "if you will indeed obey my voice." It's so tied to the obedience of the people, and they will be a special treasure to the Lord.
That if they obey his voice and keep his covenant.
Oh, yes. Yes, that's right. And then it goes on to say, "you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation." There it is, where we see that the Lord is establishing this ragtag bunch of ex-slaves as a nation. And so we know already from the covenant with Abraham that he has given them land, and now he is giving them the status of nationhood as they are going out of slavery in Egypt.
Well, as we look at these covenants, Laura, we should begin to see that nothing is impossible for God, especially going back to the covenant with Abraham, a man of 99 years of age with no children, and he's going to be the father of many nations.
And we see that what the Lord is doing with this covenant and giving the law to the people is he is establishing his expectation for how the people are going to act. But this also sets up the cycle of blessing and curses that we see in the book of Judges and all through the Old Testament, actually. And this is the plan and the hope that the Lord has, that people are going to be able to comply and follow the things that he said. But we soon see that following and obeying strictly the words of the law is very challenging for the people of Israel.
Well, we do see the humanity of people and their inability to always do what the Lord's wanting them to do. Because God told Moses to take these words and speak them to the children of Israel, which he did. And then in verse 8 it says, "Then all the people answered together and said, all that the Lord has spoken we will do." And of course we know later on in Exodus 20, when Moses goes up to get the Ten Commandments, he comes back and finds them worshiping false idols and golden idols and things, and to the point that he even broke the Ten Commandments.
The first five books of the Bible are called the Pentateuch, and it is the writing of Moses. But when we get to Deuteronomy, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, Deuteronomy is called second reading. And so it is the second reading of the law, where Moses calls all the people together and he reads all the law to all the people shortly before he is no more. It was so important for Moses to make sure that the people knew the words of the law.
Well, it's just a good message to us, all of us, our listeners, you and me, that we don't need to give lip service to God.
That is so true, Mike. Heartfelt obedience is what honors the Lord more than anything.
Well, Laura, let's move into the covenant that God had with David.
As I said earlier, these covenants are building on each other. So we move from a covenant with a man in Abraham, from a nation with Moses, to now God is making a covenant with David that there will be a man from the line of David who will be on the throne of God forever. David's throne is established as a perpetual throne. And of course, we recognize that as being Jesus Christ, who is the one who is on the throne of David. But as God's people entered the promised land and took up the conquest and settlement of the promised land, they eventually demanded a king. And the Lord had already set up that if the people demanded a king, they weren't going to be happy with the king in the long run, because the king was going to oppress them. And we do see that with King Solomon. But this was also stroking their desires to be a nation like the other nations around them, because before they had a king, they were just a group of tribes who were working together in unity. But now they want a king because they see other nations and they want to be like the other nations. So King Saul was appointed as God's king over Israel, but he failed to obey God and was rejected. And then God chose David to be king over Israel. And so David became a successful leader, and his heart's desire was to establish a temple that God would again reside with his people in a temple. But the Lord said to David, "Your hands are too dirty, too much blood on your hands from the work and the war that you have been a part of in your life. And so you will not build me a temple, but your son, King Solomon, will build me a temple." We see that these covenants build on one another. And so we're going to read parts of 2 Samuel 7.
God spoke to Nathan to take a message to David. And picking up at 2 Samuel 7, verse 8, it says, "Now therefore, thus shall you say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the sheepfold, from following the sheep, to be ruler over my people, over Israel. And I have been with you wherever you have gone, and have cut off all your enemies from before you, and have made you a great name, like the name of the great men who are on the earth. Moreover, I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them, that they may dwell in a place of their own and move no more. Nor shall the sons of wickedness oppress them any more, as previously, since the time that I commanded judges to be over my people Israel, and have caused you to rest from all your enemies. Also the Lord tells you that he will make you a house. When your days are fulfilled and you rest with your fathers, I will set up your seed after you, who will come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be his father, and he shall be my son. If he commits iniquity, I will chasten him with the rod of men and with the blows of the sons of men. But my mercy shall not depart from him, as I took it from Saul, whom I removed from before you. And your house and your kingdom shall be established forever before you. Your throne shall be established forever. According to all these words and according to all this vision, so Nathan spoke to David."
Well, Mike, in this covenant, God promised a descendant of David to reign on the throne over the people of God. As we said, this is a continuation of the previous covenants. Primarily, the most important verses in all that you just read are 2 Samuel 7, 12 and 13, because here's where the promise of God comes. "When your days are fulfilled," the Lord spoke to David, "and you rest with your fathers, I will set up your seed after you, who will come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom, and he shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever." And then if you look down in verse 16, and it says, "And your house and your kingdom shall be established forever before you. Your throne shall be established forever." And so, Mike, this is talking about two different things. This is talking about King Solomon, who will build the temple. And if King Solomon is disobedient, he would be chastised. But it is also talking about the kingdom of God, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, that Jesus Christ is on the throne of David forever and ever. You know, we also look back in 2 Samuel 7:9, the Lord spoke and said, I have been with you forever. I have made your name great, and I have cut off all your enemies before you. So we see that the Lord has been with David and promises to be with David forever and ever. So it is a great continuation of the covenant to create a kingdom out of the line of David.
Laura, I can see where these covenants are all leading up to the new covenant, which I feel like we need to go to now. We've kind of covered all the other covenants, but I think we need to spend a little time, the rest of the time we have today, talking about the new covenant.
Mike, as we've already established, we see that the people of Israel had a very, very challenging time keeping up with the law. They were not able to get to the point of righteousness through the law, because every time they sinned, they were separated from God. And so the Lord knew that there had to be a better plan than the old covenant, the Old Testament. There had to be a new covenant. We really see the new covenant introduced in Jeremiah 31:31-34. We're going to go there and we're going to read that. But this language first used in Jeremiah's promise of rescue and renewal of the exiled people of God in Babylon. So it promises a coming day when God would make a new covenant, unlike the covenant that Israel and Judah had broken. This new covenant brings forgiveness of sins. It brings an internal renewal of the heart. It brings intimate knowledge of God. We're going to just read the new covenant language of Jeremiah 31:31-34, and then we'll talk about it.
This is Jeremiah 31, starting at verse 31. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant which they broke, though I was a husband to them, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No more shall every man teach his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for they all shall know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and their sin I will remember no more.
This is so critical, and I think most people do not know what I'm getting ready to say. But the new covenant was a covenant by God with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. And I want to explain that. That is Jeremiah 31:31. And it says, Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Israel was a united kingdom under King Saul, King David, and King Solomon. But after Solomon's reign, the kingdom was divided, and it became the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. The northern kingdom was known as Israel, and the southern kingdom was known as Judah. So the Lord is making this covenant with the divided house of Israel in Jeremiah 31:31. And he said, I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. I want everyone to notice in there, it does not say, I am making a new covenant with Christians. I'm making a new covenant with Gentiles. The Lord made the new covenant with the divided house of Israel. But when you come down through here and you read what the Lord said in Jeremiah 31, starting at verse 33, it says, But this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days. Notice he doesn't say the house of Israel and the house of Judah, but the Lord is talking about a once again united house of Israel. He's talking about Israel being one. It's not the house of Judah and the house of Israel anymore, but as a united group of one nation, one kingdom. It comes under the umbrella of the house of Israel. And so look what the Lord says that he's going to do. Number one, I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. Number two, I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No more shall every man teach his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me. From the least of them to the greatest of them, says the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity, and their sin I will remember no more. And under the new covenant, it is based on grace, grace, grace. We know that with Jesus Christ, we come to a salvation relationship with Jesus through the grace of God. The law was based on performance. That was the old covenant. But the new covenant is based on the blessing of God, the grace of God, the mercy of God.
Well, Laura, we know that His Spirit resides within us. We know for each of us, everyone listening to this, that our bodies are a temple for the Spirit of God. And that's why we need to, I need to do better about honoring my temple. But that's the thing. He lives within each of us. And I think that's what it's saying here now, that they shall all know me, from the least to the greatest, for I will forgive their iniquity and their sin, but He is within us.
Well, Mike, we see that much of the New Testament is concerned to show how Jesus fulfills these covenant promises and what life looks like for people who are under the New Covenant, who were brought into the relationship of the New Covenant based on the grace of God. The only way under the Old Covenant that people could come into atonement for their sins is they had to sacrifice animals. But now we know that with Jesus Christ, we have a one-time atoning sacrifice for our sins. We don't sacrifice animals anymore to pay for our sins because we have an everlasting new covenant. The Lord was faithful to raise up a king from the line of David who would restore that which was broken. So, Mike, we see in the book of Luke that the new covenant was inaugurated by the shedding of the innocent blood of Jesus Christ.
Well, and we see that when he instituted the Last Supper. So let me read from Luke 22, starting at verse 14. When the hour had come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him. Then he said to them, With fervent desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I will no longer eat of it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Then he took the cup and gave thanks and said, Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it and gave it to them, saying, This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, he also took the cup after supper, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. And Laura, I just noticed that he first talks about the bread, but he talks about the new covenant with the blood. Because he said, This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. But then, when he took the cup, representing his blood, he said, This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you.
As we notice in this passage in Luke chapter 22, actually there were two cups. Because in Luke 22:17, he took the cup and he gave thanks and he gave it to them to divide it among themselves. And then he took the bread and he said, This is my body which is given for you. But then after the supper, so he had finished the Passover meal, but after the supper he said, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. As he was taking that final cup, that was the demonstration that when his blood was shed, the cup of the new covenant, the atonement of the new covenant would have been paid. Our sins would have been atoned for in the shedding of the blood of Jesus Christ. And so this is what he's demonstrating when he says that.
Well, Laura, this has been an amazing journey from the covenant starting back with Noah, going all the way forward to the new covenant, talking about the shedding of his blood as the new covenant, which was fulfilled when he gave himself up on the cross. It's just such a complete picture, and yet when you think about how much time had passed from the first covenant to the last, to the new covenant, I don't see how anyone can question that God orchestrated all this.
Thousands of years had passed, but as we have talked about these five main covenants, we see that it does culminate in a new covenant, but the covenant was with Israel and Judah. And so it's very important for us to understand how we come into the blessing of that covenant as Gentile believers. And on one of the previous programs, we talked about the fact that in the discussion of the Bible, there are two people groups, Jews and Gentiles. Of course, those groups are broken down into many subgroups. But also we see Jews who believe in Jesus as the Messiah and Jews who do not, and Gentiles who believe that Jesus is the Savior of the world and Gentiles who do not. But the covenants were actually created with Israel. And the Lord said early in the covenant with Abraham, I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you. The covenant was never made with Gentile Christians that we are. And so when we have this understanding of Scripture, it makes us understand the importance of our relationship with Israel. And we know in the New Testament, in the book of Ephesians, that it says that God is creating one new man out of the two, out of the Jews and the Gentiles, the Jews and the nations, that is coming together as the bride of Christ. It's not a Jewish bride. It's not a Gentile bride. There is one bride, and the Jews and the Gentiles are coming together under these covenants. We are saved by the salvation through our belief in Jesus Christ, but it is the blessing of the covenant that came with Israel.
And it makes me think, by analogy, part of my practice is having children be adopted by other people. When you have that adoption hearing with the judge, you hear you have a child that's not related by blood in any way to the people that want to adopt him or her. But one of the questions that I would ask of the prospective parents, do you want to adopt this child the same as if born of your body? And they will say yes. So we're adopted in, but we're part of the body of Christ.
And that's what it says in the New Testament. We are grafted in. We come together. And so one of the things that I want to conclude this program on is to say we see the Jews and the Gentiles come together in the body of Christ. It was God's plan always from the beginning.
Amen, Laura. Amen. Well, let's close with a prayer. Lord Jesus, thank you for your word. Thank you for your covenants, Lord, that have spanned thousands of years. And thank you for the fulfillment of those covenants that are still being fulfilled even today. Lord, I pray that the hearts and ears of the listeners of this program today have been touched in a way to burn a fire in their heart, to look into the Word, to look at these covenants, to realize that there is one new man made up of both the Jewish people and the Gentiles. In Jesus' name, amen. Till next week, God bless.
God bless you.
Thank you for listening to this edition of Where He Leads Me with Mike and Laura Harris. To find out more, go to whereheleadsme.org or email Mike and Laura at whereheleadsmeinfo@gmail.com.